هيا على الفلاح.
My brothers and sisters in Islam, then after that, an amazing thing happened. We all know that there's been battles and the Meccans, the Kuffar, are against the Muslims all this time. They've been a threat. The Muslims can't live their life. Finally, the Battle of the Trenches was over. Then, the turnaround. The Treaty of Hudaybiyyah. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw a dream. In that dream, he saw that he was going with his companions, wearing the ihram. He saw himself going to Umrah, wearing this ihram, which meant that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that you are going to do Umrah. So if Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw that he's doing Umrah, it meant that he and his companions were going to do Umrah, no doubt. So he got his companions, 1,400 companions, and one hypocrite was with them. They didn't know he was a hypocrite, one man. And the rest of them, all true Sahabas, from the Muhajirin and the Ansar. And he took with him sheep. They are the Udhiyah. They got their weapons, but they didn't wear their weapons. They put their weapons on their camel, sheathed, meaning in their pockets, was to show that they were not going to fight anyone. They were traveling in peace, merely just to perform a pilgrimage of Umrah to Mecca. Mecca is still in hostility with them. They're still at war with them. There's no treaty between them. So what happened? They went heading towards Mecca. The Muslims who were with him, they're all 100% convinced that they are going to go in with some kind of miracle. Allah is going to open the way for them. They're going to be at peace. They're going to do their whole Umrah, and all those enemies are not going to touch them, and then they're going to return. That's what they thought, because the Prophet ﷺ saw the dream. On their way, the Prophet ﷺ reached close to Mecca, and as they were about to enter, his camel, al-Qaswar, Prophet's camel, refused to go forward. He tried and tried, but the camel turned around. The Sahabas followed him, and he sat in a little area called Hudaybiyyah. The Sahabas looked and said, "Ya Rasulullah, this animal has become stubborn. The shaitan must have done something to it." So the Prophet ﷺ said, "Never. She is commanded. She goes in the will of Allah. This cannot be a mistake. Allah has something in store for us. We can't enter. Let's see what happened." Now doubts upon doubts start to creep into the minds of some of the companions. Questions, questions. As they were sitting there, they're not moving. They're not entering and they're not moving. The Meccans found out. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala kept them there so that news can get around in Mecca and everybody starts talking. What do they want? Have they come to take over Mecca? That's what they're naturally going to think. They sent 80 of their warriors. They went all the way to Hudaybiyyah, where they were camped. But obviously the Prophet ﷺ is ready and prepared. He's got his soldiers, guards outside. And instead of the 80 soldiers, the Muslimin surrounded them and they captured them. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent them on a mission of peace. So then the Rasul ﷺ, instead of taking these 80 soldiers as captives, what did he do to them? He returned them back. Meccans were a bit confused themselves. They thought, "You're not fighting us, you just returned our soldiers and you had the upper hand. We better find out what's going on here." So they started to send representatives, people to talk on behalf of Mecca. They sent the first guy by the name of Buday. Buday is not one of the Meccan tribes, but he's an ally. So he went to the Prophet ﷺ and he said to him, "Muhammad, what are you here for? I mean, I see that you've got your weapons on the backs of your camel, so you're not fighting. But at the same time, you're not entering and you're just staying here. What do you want?" So the Prophet ﷺ said to him the following, "Ya Buday, have your people not suffered already too much from the Battle of Khandaq? Aren't they tired from that?" He said, "Yes." He said, "We have come in peace, openly to do our Umrah, and we offer you peace. If you allow us to come in, we will go in, do our Umrah and exit. Nobody will be harmed. And if you don't like us to be in your presence, then you can leave for a couple of days, we'll do our Umrah if you're afraid, and then we'll exit and you come back in. But if they want to fight us, and that's the only way, the Prophet ﷺ said, then he said, by God, I will not move until Allah decides the fate between us. So the Meccans are now afraid. They're thinking, we don't want this news to get out, to think that we are preventing people from doing Umrah. Wallahi, the Arabs and the tribes will go against us. It's a custom of the Arabs. Now, Buday, this guy, he comes back and he says to them, Ya Ahla Quraysh, leave him alone. Wallahi, I don't know, except that he's coming peace. This is what he's saying. They go, no, we're not convinced. So they sent another guy by the name of Urwa. And Urwa was related to Mecca. He comes up to the Prophet ﷺ and says to him, let me reason with you, Ya Muhammad. Let's negotiate a little bit. He says, what are you here for? And the Prophet ﷺ said to him exactly the same thing he said to the other guy. So Urwa, he turns to the Prophet ﷺ, it's as if he didn't hear what the Prophet said. He turned a deaf ear. So he said to him, O Muhammad, I'm looking around you, and all I see is people I don't know. Who are these people? Who are these Ansar people? And he had some other people from different Arab tribes. He goes, who are they? They're nobody. You're only here bringing division between the people, in purifying the sanctity of Mecca. So the Prophet ﷺ repeated, he said, Wallahi, I am not being sent to cut off the kinship, but to connect them. And I have not come to fight, but to create peace. And Mecca is honored. We have not come to impurify, but to purify it. But then again, you're talking to a brick wall. The guy doesn't want this. He's come to make trouble. He wants them to return. Don't come. I don't want to hear anything of that. So it's as if he didn't hear him again. He says, see these people that are around you, Ya Muhammad? We don't know them. So what do you expect them they're going to do? If you go into a fight with us and we beat you, these people are going to abandon you. Now as soon as he said that statement, one of the most softest and kindest companions of the Prophet ﷺ suddenly transformed from this sweet, kind, soft person within about 2 seconds from 0 to 100. And he said something in reply to Urwa that was so vile, vulgar, and so offensive to him that you would have never, ever, ever thought that it was him who would ever say something like that. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. As soon as Urwa said, these people are going to abandon you when the going gets tough, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was so enraged, says, go and such of a sexual act with your goddess. And Urwa turns to him, he would have replied to him, but he said, Who said this word? And they said, it's Ibn Abu Quhafa. Abu Bakr al-Anwar was also called the son of Abu Quhafa. And he said, Ya Ibn Abi Quhafa, if it wasn't that in our past you did me a favor, I would have today responded to you in the same way. And that was the Arab custom, that they never forget a favor someone had done to them, Muslim or non-Muslim, right? Urwa then turns to the Prophet ﷺ and he starts to tell him, this is our offer, you've got to return. Rasul ﷺ saw straight through the manipulation of Urwa. Suddenly, as they were trying to talk, the Salat of Dhuhr came about. And Bilal radiallahu anhu stood up and made the adhan. The Prophet ﷺ said, I'm going to pray, ignored him. And suddenly Urwa, before his eyes, he saw the Muslims, these companions, who were full of rage and might and chivalry. And they started to pray in a line, absolute quietness. Absolute silence behind this man, Muhammad. But before they even prayed, he saw something amazing. He saw the Prophet ﷺ making wudu, rinsing his mouth and spitting the water out, rinsing his nose and putting the water on his arms. And what's happening to the mucus and the saliva and the water? It's falling on the floor, right? Urwa says, I looked and I saw the companions racing each other to catch the water, catch the saliva, catch the mucus, and rub it on themselves. Urwa is seeing this unbelievable thing. He's never seen something like this. This is bizarre, man. This is like out of this world. Are these humans or aliens? He thought to himself. And then they line up behind the Prophet ﷺ. He's looking at all this before his eyes. From saying these people will abandon you to looking at this shock in front of him. After they finished their salat, the Prophet ﷺ came back and said, now Urwa, what are we going to negotiate? It was known to the custom of the Arabs that when two leaders meet, you touch each other's beards. So Urwa kept on touching the Prophet's beard. As he was touching his beard, there was a well-armed guard covering his entire face, his entire body, tall, strong, young man. You couldn't see his face, so Urwa didn't know who it was. He was standing with the personal guard of the Prophet on his journey, and he was holding a sword with him. Urwa put his hand on the Prophet's beard the first time, and suddenly he sees a sword tapping his hand. Second time, tapped it harder. A third time, he tapped it even harder, and the voice said to him, "If you touch the Prophet's beard one more time, I am going to detach your arm from your body." Urwa looks at this young man and says, "Who's this?" And the Prophet laughed. Why? He said, "He is your nephew." He had embraced Islam, his brother's son, and subhanAllah, Urwa was looking at this thinking, "You?" His name was Al-Mughira. He goes, "You're doing this to your uncle, and I'm the one who saved you out of that trouble that you put us in the past." And he replied to him by saying, "This is the messenger of Allah." And that's when Urwa understood that, hold on a minute, there's this religion and this prophet who was brought, you know, if it's true, a message from the heavens, then it would make sense why Islam is even greater than the blood relations. Urwa was very shocked about this. He just decided, he said, "Listen, I'm going to go back and talk to my people." He left and went back to the Meccans, and this is what he said. "O people, I have been to Persia, and I've seen the Persian king and his people. I have been to the Roman emperors, Caesar, and I've seen him and his people. And I've been to the Abyssinian kings, and I've seen the Ethiopians' kings and their people." He said, "By Allah, I have never seen any people show so much respect and loyalty to any leader in the entire world in my life as these companions show their Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If he spoke, they were absolutely silent. He would just look and they would obey. If they spoke to him, they would look down. If he was making ablution, wudu, they would race to catch the water and wipe it on themselves. My advice to you, leave them. They truly have come in peace just to do umrah. Let them do it and move away." They said to him, "Wow, out of all people, we come to you as our support, and this is what you say to us? No, no, this is not going to work." And so what happened? "We will not surrender. I am with my people, right or wrong." This group was about 40. They go out, they want to attack the Prophet. They captured them again. They go, "Oh, please let us go, let us go." So the Prophet let them go out of goodwill. So the Prophet, he thought, "Okay, this is not going well. We're going to send a representative from us to go and speak to Quraysh." So the Rasul approached Umar and said, "Ya Umar, how about you go on our behalf and try to negotiate with them? They used to be among them, they used to respect you." Umar Abdullah replied by saying, "Ya Rasulullah, if you want me, I will go. But me, then I'm the last person they're going to listen to. So I suggest Uthman ibn Affan. He's kind, he's compassionate, they still like him, they still have a soft spot for him." So the Prophet ﷺ chose Uthman Abdullah, he said, "You go and be our representative to talk." When he went in, he was supposed to come out in a few hours, he was delayed. The Meccans caught him and they wouldn't let him leave. So the Prophet ﷺ assumed that they had killed him. That's when the Prophet ﷺ lost it. He got all his companions and he went to a tree nearby, an acacia tree. And he sat underneath it, he put his right hand out, and he said, "Who will pledge allegiance with me to fight to death?" And every single one of those companions came to that tree. 1,400 companions, each one of them placing their sometimes 5 hands or 10 hands on top of each other, pledging allegiance, "We will fight till death, Ya Rasulullah." Except for one man, he was a hypocrite. Prophet saw him walking behind the camels. He said, "I see him walking behind the camels. Don't worry about it." Allah said, "Allah has bestowed his complete pleasure, unconditional pleasure, upon those who pledged allegiance with you under the tree." So they are now elites. We still mention them till today. And as for Uthman radiallahu anhu, he couldn't pledge allegiance. So what happened? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used his hand and placed it on his own hand, saying, "And my hand is on behalf of Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu." All the 1,400 companions said, "Oh, every one of us wished that we were in Uthman's place and that the Prophet's hand would have represented me." My brothers and sisters in Islam, as the Prophet ﷺ prepared himself to go in to fight, the Quraysh heard about this and they thought, man, this is getting too serious. They're scared. So they said, wait, let's send our only delegate who is the best eloquent person. His name was Suhail ibn Amr. So he comes out to the Prophet ﷺ. He is the foreign ambassador. He says, ya Muhammad, Uthman is alive, but I've come to negotiate with you. The Prophet ﷺ saw Suhail, and the Prophet, peace be upon him, he's very smart. He knows his enemies well. He knows all the people around him. This is what makes a person a good leader. So as Suhail is coming along, the Prophet ﷺ said, it is Suhail. Allah is going to make the affair easier for him. He knows Suhail is a man that can negotiate. He's got some softness in his heart. So Suhail comes along, and he said, I'm here to negotiate. So he sat with the Prophet ﷺ under the tent. Ali radiallahu anhu was the person who sat with the Prophet ﷺ to write the negotiation that had happened between the Prophet ﷺ and Suhail, the representative of Makkah. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was there, Umar was there. There were other companions who were there to witness this negotiation. And this is the one which is called the Treaty of Hudaybiyyah. They back and forth, they said, okay, we'll agree on this. Ya Muhammad, we can't let you come in now this year to do it. Because then all the Arab tribes will think that you have the upper hand. We don't want them to think that we are below you. So give us that. But you can come next year to do your umrah. The Prophet ﷺ said, okay, I agree. Then he said, what about that we negotiate 10 years of a peace treaty between us? Neither of us will attack or harm the other at all. And anyone who is our ally, you can't attack them. And anyone who is your ally, we cannot attack them. If you attack an ally of ours, it's an attack on us. And if we attack an ally of yours, even one man or one woman, it'll be an attack on you, and the treaty is off. The Prophet ﷺ agreed. This is the main part of the agreement which the Prophet ﷺ loved. 10 years of peace between the two. They can go and come, they can trade with each other, all of that. They can travel, no more harm, peace. And Muslims can give da'wah and teach Islam. The Prophet ﷺ said, I agree. But then Suhail said, but on condition. Anyone who wants to leave Islam, who wants to apostate from your people, you have to let them come back to us. We have to take them back. But anyone who leaves us and embraces Islam, you're not allowed to take him, you have to return him back to us. The Prophet ﷺ looks at him, the companions didn't like this. What's this treachery? The Prophet ﷺ said, agreed. And the Sahaba started to make noise, like, they're not happy with this. What do you mean? Why? Why? The Prophet ﷺ said, let's write this agreement. Ya Ali, write the following. In the name of Allah, the most merciful, the most compassionate. He wrote it, and then Suhail said, I don't agree to that. We don't know a God by the name of Ar-Rahman. Who's this Ar-Rahman? Strike it out, I don't agree. So the Prophet ﷺ looks at Ali radiallahu anhu, says, wipe it off. Ali radiallahu anhu says, Ya Rasulullah, wipe off Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Allah's name? He says, yes, Ya Ali, wipe it off. Ali radiallahu anhu refused to wipe it off. So Ali grabbed the pen, and he erased it. Then he said, this is an agreement between Suhail ibn Amr and Muhammad, the messenger of Allah. Suhail goes, if I acknowledged you as a messenger of God, I wouldn't have fought you. Take it out. Put Muhammad ibn Abdullah, Muhammad the son of Abdullah. Ali radiallahu anhu, Ya Rasulullah, how can we accept this? Prophet ﷺ said, show me where it is. He showed him and he struck it out with his hands. At this point, the Sahabas, they started to feel very uncomfortable. They were very angry at this treaty. They thought we've been stepped on, we've been done over, we have the power. You know, we're supposed to do Umrah this year. The Prophet ﷺ saw the dream, but we're not going in anymore. What's going on? Test of faith. Just before they wrote the rest of the agreement, a Sahabi by the name of Abu Jandal came from Makkah. He embraced Islam, says, Ya Rasulullah, I'm a Muslim, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa anna Muhammad Rasulullah. Suhail looks at him and recognizes that it's his son. It's Suhail's son, Abu Jandal. He turns to the Prophet and says, Ah, we agree, you return him. The Prophet looks and Umar looks at him and says, Ya Rasulullah, Umar, we haven't written the agreement yet. And Suhail said, There is no agreement between us if you don't send back my son. The Prophet ﷺ said, No worries, write it. Go back here, Abu Jandal. Abu Jandal doesn't know what's going on. He goes, What? The companions are with him. So the Prophet ﷺ said to Suhail, Yes, Suhail, give him to me. He said, No. He said, Please. This is the first time in the history of the Prophet's biography that we hear the Prophet ﷺ almost like he was pleading. And Suhail said, Never. So then the Prophet ﷺ looked at Abu Jandal and said to him, Ya Abu Jandal, be patient, for wallahi, Allah will give you a way out soon and whoever follows you. So they write the whole deal. The Prophet ﷺ seals it with his ring, Muhammad Rasulullah, and Suhayb walks away. 10 years of peace. Umar radiallahu anhu looks at the Prophet ﷺ. All the companions, most of them, they started to be uneasy in their hearts about this. What's going on? Not happy. Umar radiallahu anhu, knowing him, he's very vocal. He comes up and says, Ya Rasulullah, are you not the messenger of God? He said, Yes, I am. Says, are we not on the truth? He says, Yes, we are. Are they not the enemy in the kuffar? He goes, Yes. He goes, Don't we enter paradise if we die? He said, Yes. He said, Then how can you accept? And the Prophet ﷺ replied, Ya Umar, Wallahi, Allah is with us. And he will support me and give me victory, and he will not let me lose. That's all he said. He went quiet and he walked away. Then he sees Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. Umar radiallahu anhu is not happy about this. Still, he says to Abu Bakr, Ya Abu Bakr, is he not the messenger of God? Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu said, Yes, he is. Exactly as the Prophet replied. Abu Bakr replied the same words. He says, Then how can we accept to be feeble like this? And Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu replied and said, Ya Rajul, he is the messenger of Allah. And Allah will not leave him. Wallahi, he will give him victory and not make him lose. Exactly the same words as the Prophet ﷺ said. And this was an indication that whenever the Prophet ﷺ said something, he would often find that Abu Bakr ﷺ's words will always correspond almost identically with the Prophet ﷺ's words, which means Abu Bakr ﷺ was the closest in intelligence and wisdom to the Prophet ﷺ. So after that, the Prophet ﷺ, he stood up to his companions and said, Take your ihram, like cut your hair and slaughter your udhiyah. And not one of the companions obeyed. Prophet ﷺ raised his voice. No one moved. Prophet ﷺ became scared. What did he become scared about? That Allah will send down a punishment on his companions. So he left them alone and walked back in. Where did he go to? In his tent, and with him was one of his wives. Her name was Salama radiallahu anha. Salama, remember, he married her. She was older and wiser. Salama sees the Prophet really concerned. She says to him, What Ya Rasulullah? He said, I commanded them, none of them obeyed. I fear the punishment of Allah upon them. And Salama says to him, Ya Rasulullah, listen, don't worry. You go out, you slaughter your udhiyah, and you shave your hair, and leave the rest up to them. The Prophet ﷺ took his wife's advice. As soon as the companions saw him do that, they felt guilty. So then they slaughtered their sheep, and each one started to shave the hair of another. The hadith says that they shaved each other's hair with anger, and some of them, they cut, they didn't shave. So they said, Ya Rasulullah, those of us who shave, those of us who cut. Rasulullah ﷺ said, May Allah have mercy and blessing upon those who shave. Then they said, What about those who cut, Ya Rasulullah? And he repeated, May Allah have mercy upon those who shave. The And they said, Ya Rasulullah, what about those who cut? So may Allah have mercy upon those who shave. And they said, okay, well, is cutting acceptable? And he said, cutting and the ones who cut, acceptable. And so the Prophet ﷺ picked up and he said, let's go back to Medina. We didn't do Umrah. Umrah comes up and says, Ya Rasulullah, didn't you promise? You saw the dream that we're going to do Umrah. And the Prophet ﷺ replied, said, yes, and the promise is still there. Did I tell you when? Umrah was not happy. On their way to Medina, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down the entire Surah Al-Fatih, which begins with, Allah said, we have truly opened for you a clear opening of victory. The Treaty of Hudaybiyyah. What was the victory? Muslims were now for the first time recognized as an independent, powerful entity. The open da'wah now, which they have never had before. Now people embrace Islam in the hundreds, in the thousands, in the tens of thousands. This is all the Prophet ever wanted. Now there was open trade. Now the hostility had been broken. And now the message will return to the purpose the messenger was sent, and that is da'wah. All these battles and all these fighting was for what? To stop the war so that what? So that the Muslims can teach Islam. So the Prophet ﷺ can call the people and invite them to Islam. That's the purpose of Islam, my dear brothers and sisters. That's the objective of every Muslim, to teach Islam in peace and harmony. As a matter of fact, I have been sent to perfect the character and good virtues and morals of people, not war and fighting. So that's why the Prophet ﷺ immediately accepted, even if it meant that the agreement looked like the Muslims were being stepped on, but they weren't. Allah sent the verse saying, we have opened you a clear victory. It brought alliances with other Arab tribes. It opened the door to reach out to non-Muslims and empires outside of Arabia. As Allah says in the Quran, we have not sent you, O Muhammad, for any other purpose except as a mercy to mankind. And this is now